You're listening to the audio production of Dear Deb, A Woman with Cancer, A Friend with Secrets, and The Letters That Became Their Miracle by Margaret Terry, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Patty Fogarty.
Author note: We do not see things as they are. We see them as we are. Anais Nin. The stories in these letters are real events that occurred in my life. Outside my family, a few names and details have been changed to protect the privacy of those mentioned. Many people have asked me how I remembered so much from my past. There's no simple answer to that, except to say if memory is a way our heart holds on to things we cherish or things we need, my heart was crowded. Once I opened the door to the past, a few memories jumped out like a jack-in-the-box, excited to see the light of day. Others wanted to stay put, and I had to chip away at their hiding place like a miner. I am grateful to my sisters, Lisa and Deborah, to my dad and my cousin Jerry, who confirmed many childhood stories. They helped me stay as true as possible to timelines and dialogue, while respecting that each of our perspectives was unique. We are, each of us, angels with only one wing, and we can only fly by embracing one another. Luciano De Crescenzo. The Inspiration. I'm going to have a miracle. I strained to hear her words, thin, whispered sounds she wheezed with each ragged breath. I need you to help me believe it. Deb didn't say what the miracle would be, only that she was certain she would have one. We were sitting with a circle of friends who had met in the church nursery to pray with her after her recent diagnosis of stage 4 inoperable lung cancer. We all knew what inoperable meant, but didn't dare speak it aloud. Inoperable meant terminal, a word that didn't belong in a nursery, a word that didn't exist when we were children singing, "Sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me." Deb had beaten breast cancer a few years earlier. Survivor was the label she had been wearing, until that day when terminal tried to take its place. I was surprised to be invited to pray for her. You can count on me to make meals when someone's sick, or if you need help planning a fundraiser. I'm there with marketing ideas and a trunk full of donations. But praying aloud in a group makes me uncomfortable. Plus, I wasn't that close to Deb. She was a church friend I'd known for 6 years, someone who planned retreats and study groups, a can-do gal who rolled up her sleeves to help, even when she wasn't asked. I knew she loved red wine, Motown, and the Buffalo Sabres. But outside church, Deb and I didn't socialize. We didn't talk on the phone, meet for coffee, or go to the movies. I'm not sure why this happens in churches. We hug the same people every Sunday for years. We watch their children grow and we share their trials and joys. Yet for some reason, we limit our relationship to church friend. Maybe that's why I decided to join the group to pray for her. She was sick, and I thought she might need a better friend than the one I had been. After we finished praying, Deb declined all offers to make meals, clean her house, or run errands. When we asked what we could do for her, she said, "Send me encouraging words and believe in my miracle." Encouraging words was something I could do. I've been a storyteller since I was 6 years old, when my mother had her first series of electroshock therapy treatments. I made up stories to keep my sisters quiet while Mom slept. She slept a lot. Sleep was her refuge, her only sanctuary from the depression battles she lost, no matter how many electrocurrents assaulted her body. In those days, we didn't have books in our house, but we had the Sears catalog, filled with pictures of smiling children dressed for every occasion. My sisters and I would snuggle shoulder to shoulder on our big, old, weathered couch and shuffle those catalog pages back and forth until we found the right shoes with matching purses to wear on our couch adventures. We could travel to faraway lands with my imagination the navigator, and my sisters a loyal crew who hungered for magic as much as I did. The first day I sat down to write Deb, I struggled with finding words other than, "I believe in your miracle." What could I say that was encouraging when Deb's doctors weren't? For 10 days, I emailed Pollyanna snippets that sounded hollow, my words echoing my lack of faith in her miracle. The day Deb received the news she had a brain tumor that had to be removed before her lung treatments could start, I felt dizzy thinking about how she'd stay hopeful with two cancers to fight. I knew Deb was strong. She was tall and athletic, played on a women's hockey team. She was also a woman of faith and could fight this battle mentally and physically. But cancer in her brain and lungs had to be terrifying. That's when my letters changed. I didn't know how it felt to have cancer, but I knew about fear. I thought of all the times I was afraid of things out of my control, things I might have shared with Deb if we had been closer friends or if we'd had more time. So I began to tell her. I wrote about my divorce and how I didn't see it coming. I wrote about getting caught shoplifting and about the best dancer I knew, who was a man with no legs. When Deb responded, "No matter how sick I feel, your letters give me something to look forward to," I kept writing. She was too sick to eat, but not too sick to read. Deb's illness gave me the chance to press my face against the window of my life, and what I saw was startling. I saw miracles that had been waiting for me to give them a voice. Deb began sharing her letters with friends and family, and the letters took flight. In 3 months, hundreds of people from 7 countries were reading the Dear Deb letters every day. Strangers wrote who were struggling with their lives yet refused to let go of hope. Some talked about their own miracles, others yearned for one. As I wrote, I was aware that Deb and I were building a bridge we would never cross. Bridges to intimacy take years. I knew I was gaining something and losing it at the same time. I was riding the crest of a wave that would crash when it reached the shore, but I kept riding it, riding and hoping that as long as I kept writing, Deb would keep living. In 6 months, I wrote 102 letters to her. I only saw her 3 times during those 6 months, but a lifetime passed between us that created a bond that defied time. She refused to consider how much time she had. Instead, she concentrated on living, and she was busy making plans right up until the moment she took her last breath. Deb was 55 years old when she died. What follows are 55 Dear Deb letters, one for each year she graced this world with her beautiful presence. Real Family. Dear Deb, "Is your dad a real dad, Mom?" Patrick stood beside me in front of the sink in the thimble-sized bathroom. He leaned over the counter and pressed his nose against the mirror. "Yes, he's a real dad," I smiled at him in the mirror, batting my eyelashes to check if my mascara had set. I had applied waterproof just in case tears ambushed me when I saw him. "He's my dad, honey." My sons knew my sisters and my mom, who had visited us in Minnesota over the years, but they had never met my father. That fall, Dad had decided it was time to meet his grandsons. Michael and Patrick were 11 and 8 and didn't know much about him other than his name was Donald, his high school friends called him Ducky, and he lived in Ohio. There had been promises to visit over the years, but we never made it happen. The letters and cards I sent with school pictures and family photos were as close as my dad wanted to be to me. Beyond updating my address book, I didn't do much to nurture a relationship with him either. He was my real dad, but we hadn't had a real relationship since I left home in my early 20s. When I announced his visit, Michael and Patrick acted like Christmas was on its way instead of my dad. They had a grandfather. They loved the mystery of the stranger who fathered me suddenly appearing at our doorstep. Dad had aged well. He was more handsome than in the 70s, when people mistook him for Sonny Bono. His hair was peppered with white, but thick and lush as a rich carpet. He wore a soft cream V-neck sweater with a pink-colored shirt underneath and gray flannel pants. No wonder his friends called him Dapper Don. The boys had been playing capture the flag in the yard, waiting for his arrival. By the time they tumbled into the kitchen, Patrick's new khaki pants were covered in grass stains, and Michael's pale blue button-down shirt was flecked with prickly pine needles. Their eyes gleamed as they stood in front of us with their eager smiles. I wanted to throw my arms around them and exclaim, "Look, Daddy, look what I made. Aren't they beautiful?" But I stopped myself. I wasn't going to let Dad see how much I cared about him being proud of me. After a 20-year absence in my life, I was surprised I cared at all. I stood in between Michael and Patrick and draped an arm over each of their shoulders. "Dad, this is Michael, and this is Patrick." Michael stretched his arm out to take my father's hand. "Hi, Grandpa. I'm Michael," he chirped. I thought my heart would burst out of my chest like a cartoon rocket. "Oh, my gosh. Oh, my." Dad shook Michael's hand and stepped back. He cleared his throat, coughed, and wiped his eyes with the back of his hand. He looks like me. He could have been my twin. Dad held his palm against his heart and sat at the kitchen table. He couldn't stop staring at Michael. "It's uncanny," he said, shaking his head back and forth. "I just can't believe the resemblance." Michael sat facing him. "You looked like me when you were 11, Grandpa?" "I sure did, pal. I'm going to send you a picture of me in grade school so you can see for yourself." Dad leaned back and placed his hands flat on the table. Michael imitated him, peering over his own hands to see if their hands looked alike, too. I felt a curtain lift as I remembered moments of my childhood. Dad's strong, masculine hands, always immaculate, nails trimmed evenly. Hands that swung me in circles playing airplane. Hands that showed me how to catch a ball. Hands that clapped the loudest when I bowed at the curtain calls of my high school plays. I felt a powerful urge to rush over and stand between my son and father at the table. My desire to grab both of their hands and hang on made me feel like I was being carried by a current strong enough to launch me over a waterfall. I yearned to know what it would feel like to touch them both at the same time, to be connected, and to feel what other families felt, families who celebrated holidays together, families who learned forgiveness, and who were unafraid of their pasts. But I didn't move. A nerve twitched under my eye. I held my finger on the pulse until it stopped. Patrick joined them at the table. "I'm glad you're here, Grandpa." He pulled on his wrist like he was playing tug-of-war with his arms. "Hey, Grandpa," Michael asked, "I've got a question for you." "Okay, kiddo," Dad answered. He leaned forward. "Shoot." "How come it took you so long to meet us? I'm 11 now, you know." He picked a pine needle off his sleeve and flicked it on the floor. "Well, now, I guess that's the million-dollar question, Michael." Dad heaved a great sigh and leaned back. "It's a very good question, Michael. Very good." He exhaled a whistle with no tune and looked at me for help. I shrugged my shoulders. What could I say to help him when I didn't know why he wasn't in my life? I had asked him many times to come to Minnesota to meet my sons, but it had been his choice to stay away. "Grandpa," Michael tapped Dad's hand with his forefinger, "why didn't you come here before?"
"The truth is," Dad cleared his throat. "The truth is, I don't have an answer to that, Michael. I really don't know why it has taken me so long to come here and meet you."
He hung his head low and stared at his lap. Patrick and Michael studied him, the father of my childhood, who was once a boy who looked like them. Dad peered up at them, his eyes misted. "But now that I'm here, I'm hoping I can be part of your family." He grinned a boyish grin. "Starting right now, right here, if you'll let me."
Michael stood up and beamed. "You are our family, Grandpa. Jeez, your mom's dad."
"Yeah," Patrick echoed. "You're our mom's dad. You're family already." They threw themselves on him and hugged him shamelessly. They loved him because he was family, and they loved him because he was there. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.